before still here?
Yes.
Okay. So we are going to the next part, which is adaptive immunity. But today we will touch on the humoral immune response only. Okay. But next Thursday, right, we will go to the part called cell mediated, but it is in the same category. So like I said, humoral, when you hear the word humoral, you're thinking about B cell, right? And you have B cell that produce antibody like a membrane bound antibody here, and you have some B cell that secreted. See, they produce a lot of antibody out. But this side we will touch next week, okay? And like I said, the adaptive can be called in by many names, like a specific immunity, which is because it's specific. Acquired immunity is need time to develop this immunity. Major characteristics of adaptive immunity is specificity, diversity, memory, cell and non-cell recognition. Now, you're not gonna kill whatever that come in. You, like I mentioned from the previous lecture, that you need to get educated. The cell need to get educated to be able to distinguish between cell and non-cell antigen. The cell has to go to school to learn and memorize things. When you go out from the school, you have a knowledge to manage the infection, okay? In the school, you have so many students, right? You can be good in a different way, and you can recognize things, like you can remember things in the different, well, you can memorize different things. And the cell can be, after you get educated, your killing will be specific. It's not gonna be like T cell that recognize virus, not gonna be T cell that handle the bacteria, okay? You put the right man to the right job, basically. So this is the same slide. So it is, hopefully it's in your roadmap. What would be the component of our immune system, okay? Again, so this is something that mimics to the other thing that I already mentioned about it, okay? So let me introduce the player first for the innate immunity. So you have main player in this story. First of all, you have B cell. Actually, B cell originate from bone marrow, right? And it produces antibody. You already know about that. It has high diversity, but very specific. Each B cell recognize different antigen, okay? And antigen, you know, one protein, you have so many epitope, right? You have a specific antibody to each epitope. And B cell form memory. In order to do a good job, you need help from something called helper T cell for differentiation to memory B cell and plasma blast, okay? So this is the plasma blast. So it's gonna be, I told you it's factory of the antibody. So you have to be big, right? A little bit chubby. So you produce a lot of antibody. You have a memory B cell after you get first infection, your body produces memory B cell. When you get the second wave of infection, basically you memorize it. And the response will be very quick after the first time. And then your second time of infection, it will be a lot easier for your body to deal with that. The next players that we are going to talk about today is the T cell. So everything starts from naive, right? T cell, basically they can categorize based on their marker on the cell surface. the marker for the helper T cell is the CD4. But if it is the marker for cytotoxic T cell is CD8. But the general marker for T cell is CD3. So if it is the right way, you have to call this cell CD3 positive, CD4 positive. This one should be CD3 positive, CD8 positive. Okay, so CD4 can differentiate into two categories. First one is called Th1 and Th2. This is based on the cytokine that they have. And then this cell, basically this one, they help B cell to, like I said, differentiate or function. And CD4 usually bind to the antigen presenting cell that present the antigen via MHC class II. But CD8 will be the cell that recognize antigen presenting cell that present antigen via MHC class I. So the process of antigen presentation will be discussed in this section later, okay? So this T cell, I told you, T cell made in bone marrow but mature or educate in thymus. Okay, helper T cell, the name, they help other cell, right? So helper T cell help B cell to produce antibody. It is a high diversity but very specific. That means you have a lot of T cell that memorize different things, which is very specific. Cytotoxic T cell or CD8 can directly kill infected cell and cancer cell. Okay. This one, T cell do not recognize the whole antigen. The chunk of antigen, they're not gonna recognize it like that. They recognize the small fragment. So it gotta be something that chops the antigen into small pieces, right? They're not like macrophage. They eat everything, right? They get a chunk of antigen in and chop, 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 eat. No, this one, they are like kind of like high class cell. They need to get everything in a small piece. They don't do like, they're not greedy. They like a small little thing. But this small little thing has to be in the context of an MSC, okay? And it form memory. So B cell has memory, T cell has memory as well. Next one, if it's the antigen presenting cell. So you have basically macrophage, dendritic cell, B cell, like antigen presenting cell. So this one, like antigen presenting cell or macrophage, eat the pathogen in, right? It doesn't matter. It can be a big antigen. They chop, 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 and then put it on top of the MHC, either class one or class two, and present it into T cell. It's kind of like you're not gonna give a gift to people without wrapping it up. So this is kind of thing that antigen presenting cell do, okay? Almost all cell type can serve as some form of antigen presenting cell, but the professional antigen presenting cell mean that present antigen very, very well. They capture, like dendritic cell, they capture antigen very, very good in the immature form of dendritic cell. But once it's become mature, they start to process antigen better. This is, I would say, let's say, the pathogen come in, right? The body has the cell called immature dendritic cell that has ability to grab the pathogen. They are a good grabber, basically. But once they grab the antigen in, it's got to be something now that enhance them to become mature. Once they become mature, they start to process antigen in a very efficient way to present antigen in the context of MHC. This is what dendritic cell do. And peptide plus MHC class one will present to CD8, whereas the peptide that present in MHC class two will present to CD4 T cell. Okay, T cell not gonna recognize the antigen without MHC, put it that way, okay? If it is the major histocompatibility complex that we're talking about, mice or animal, we call MSC. But in human, we call HLA, human leukocyte antigen, but it is function the same. Their function is the same, okay? And I told you, right, antibody is the way, well, this is Ajahn Pawey told you yesterday. So in this story, we will have the weapon as well, okay? Antibody is one of it. So you have the antigen here, right? The big antigen, but each antigen, the big protein, has the epitope on it. Epitope means the little piece of the antigen that can interact with different antibody via the Fab. Right here, for example, you have the yellow one, the red one, green one, blue one here, but the only yellow one that fit with the antibody, right? So it's very specific. And you have five classes of the antibody. We will talking about the main function of antibody by the end of this lecture, but basically it can inhibit the pathogen. It can form agglutination, precipitate, and complement fixation. We're talking about complement fixation before, right? And the cell that produce antibody, we call it plasmablast. Okay. Once you go out from this class, when people ask you what kind of cell produce antibody, you can say B cell, but it has to be a B cell that differentiate into a plasmablast cell. And this is just two words that I want you to know that antibody type of B cell antigen can be T independent. That is T independent, you don't need help from T cell, right? And this type of antigen are bacterial polysaccharide or repeating determinant, like bacteria is basically on the cell surface of bacteria. We call it T independent. And T dependent mean that you need help from T cell before the B cell get activated and then do the function like differentiate into a plasmablast cell, okay? And another weapon is the cytokine, but this is something that I think for myself, I look at it as if it is the language that the cell talk to one another. But different cytokine can promote different things, okay? So this is, for example, what should I say? GM-CSF can basically help myeloid lineage cell to be more active. IL-15 can help with the CD8 T cell, something like that, and you will learn more shortly, okay? And it is this cytokine is the messenger between cell of immune system and secret by basically immune cell. But some chemokine can secret by some cell like epithelium cell as well. And this is the major histocompatibility complex, right? I mentioned about this molecule already. So this is the molecule. And today we are going to focus on the MSC class 2, which is the MSC that use, when you are going to present the antigen to CD4 T cell, you have to wrap it in the context of MSC class 2, okay? So now this is, I think these two slides will basically summarize what happened in the humoral immune response. Okay, so I think you already know that immune progenitor cell, you probably found it in the bone marrow, right? And it can be CD T cell, naive T cell, naive B cell. Okay, when it is in the naive state, they express, I should put CD3 here too. They express CD4, CD8, and then this B cell can express CD19, but that is too detailed. We are going to talk about the process, okay? When they are in the naive form, right, they have CD3, CD4, CD8, and they have something called T cell receptor here. So if this T cell receptor bind to cell antigen, that means your body antigen, they will get destroyed. They can't mature anymore. What happens if the T cell that recognize cell antigen become mature? What would be the consequence?
It will kill our own cells, which will
kill their own.
Yeah.
Autoimmune response.
Okay, that is very good. Okay, so it will cause the autoimmune diseases, right? And the host will not be happy about it. But if you look at this T cell, it's naive T cell, right? And it's not recognized the cell antigen. They will start to mature, proliferate, and differentiate. And it can be two pathways that they can go. They can either become CD8 positive T cell, or they can become CD4 positive T cell. So today, since we are going to discuss about humoral immune response, we will see the link between those two cells, how it works, what would be something that happened after they meet one another, okay? So this chart here is previous slide, okay? Let's start here. Everything starts with eating, right? So antigen-presenting cell in this place, I put the macrophage in. They see the antigen, of course, they eat and chop the antigen because they are antigen-presenting cell, right? So if you look here, up here, once they chop the antigen, this is antigen-presenting cell on top. Sorry, it's a little bit too small, but I hope you can still see it. They present antigen in the context of MHC class II molecule. This is antigen, okay? And they have T cell has their own T cell receptor here, okay? So this T cell receptor will recognize both MHC and antigen together, and it get help from CD4 that expressed on the cell surface of CD4 ligand and CD4 expressed on the cell surface of T cell here that will interact with the MHC class II as well. It's kind of stabilized the interaction between TCR and MHC class II. So you can see here the purple here is the whole molecule of CD4, right? And it kind of like interact with MHC class II in this picture. So this cell, this is something that happened. The cell here, you remember that they have destiny to become a CD4 T cell here, will interact with antigen presenting cell. Once this process happens, it become activate and it start to proliferate. You will have many of kind of like the twin CD4 T cell there. But every single T cell here, they have main rule. They have three things happen here. This helper T cell, right, activate. And the first one, they will interact with B cell. Of course, this B cell has to encounter the pathogen that they recognize should be the same. So the helper T cell now can interact with the B cell by, you remember the B cell is also antigen presenting cell as well, and they produce they chop the peptide and then present it to T cell receptor here, and you need help. This kind of thing called co-stimulatory molecule. And then the signal that's sent by helper T cell will trigger the B cell to differentiate into either plasma cell, okay? And this plasma cell will produce ton of antibody there. And this B cell can also differentiate to become a memory cell what they memorize, they memorize the same antigen. Let's say you get infected by COVID today, right? Your body start to cope with it, and then they generate some kind of cell called memory B cell. So let's say now you recover from COVID infection. Next 2 years, the same pathogen come back in. This memory B cell will act very quick, and hopefully you won't get sick for the second infection, okay? And the second job is that once they get interact with B cell, they get activated. They produce some cytokine. I mentioned that cytokine is the kind of like message between immune cell, right? So they enhance other immune cell to perform more function. Like they enhance inflammation, they enhance NK cell activity, they enhance macrophage to eat more and more, they enhance neutrophil to have ability to get rid of the pathogen more, okay? So at the end, basically you enhance the inflammation. And also these helper T cell can also help to differentiate CD8 T cell to become a cytotoxic T cell as well. That is something that we are going to discuss in the future, okay? I mean, next week, not the like very far future. So each helper T cell can only recognize one antigen in the whole world. So it's very specific, right? But it doesn't mean that you have only few T cell in your body. You have something like a whole repertoire of T cell in your body. But each T cell is very specific. It's specific for one antigen in the whole world. Okay, it's not something that you're gonna see T cell number one interact with same antigen as T cell number two. Or maybe, well, I should put it this way. Different epitope can happen, same antigen, but they recognize different epitope, the small little epitope, okay? Oops, okay. So, I already mentioned about it. This is something that called epitope, different shape, different amino acid sequences, right? This is a whole antigen, this is epitope. Multiple T cell could respond to different antigen on particular whole antigen, like this one. You may have T cell recognize this one, T cell recognize this one, T cell recognize this one, even though it's same antigen, but you will not have same T cell recognize the same epitope, because this is the beauty of immune response. And T cell can recognize non-pathogen as well, like allergen, or sometimes it's kind of like they react to, like we mentioned earlier, that they react to our own tissue, so it's become autoimmune, okay? However, some pathogen, they are target immune cell. For example, HIV infect CD4 T cell, right? So once they infect CD4 T cell, you learn from the previous slide that CD4 T cell has so many functions. They interact with so many cells. Once they get destroyed, of course, the adaptive immunity will be dampened. So basically, they damage your adaptive immunity. That is why in the HIV patient, sometimes we call them immunocompromised hosts. That means they have a weak immune response. Why is weak? Because the virus basically destroys their immune cell. Okay, so this is something that, well, a lot, many time that if people get infected by HIV and they treat them, and you have they have a certain amount of CD4, they can still survive, even though that immune response is not that good. Unfortunately, they have to be careful. Don't get infected by something that usually may not cause a severe problem in the healthy host, But if you are immunocompromised, you get really sick. For example, if you get you already has you have a lot of TB incident in HIV infected patient because their immune system is very weak. Now, this is going to be a very complicated one, but we go through it. Okay. One thing that I need you to know that MSC class 2, they are, what should I say? They are very, they are specific to extracellular antigen, like bacteria considered to be extracellular antigen, right? However, it's always some exceptional. For example, Bucoduria pseudomallei that you are going to learn with Ajahn Pawet is intracellular bacteria. It might not follow this rule, okay? And viruses, they are intracellular antigen. Maybe MSC class 1 is not really effective in order to cope with virus. But it doesn't mean that you don't need it. You need it. You still need it, but just right now, you just remember that extracellular antigen match with MSC class 2. And this is something that happened in antigen presenting cell like a dendritic cell. And once the pathogen come in, right, it get destroyed. And on the right-hand side here, you can see that MSC class 2 is produced by the host. And then there are so many processes that finally the MSC class 2 and antigen met one another. Then you they put the antigen, the little antigen that they chop, into the MSC class 2. But however, in the whole process, right here, you can see here, right? Look at this one on this side. Your body, the lysosome. I mean, you produce the MSC molecule here, right? And basically it's go through the whole process. And during the process, you have something that are looking like decoy. It's mimic the little epitope to prevent the intracellular peptide to jump into the MSC class 2. So you're not gonna present your own antigen to the T cell. But at the end, when you have a good MSC molecule, you kind of like open that pocket up and let the peptide jump in. So it's very complicated process, but it needed because you don't want to present your own antigen, okay? And this one, once you put antigen into your this is the antigen route, right? This is the a pathogen route. And then you then produce the MSC class 2 on the cell surface of antigen presenting cell. And you have MSC and little peptide here that can interact with the T cell. And the molecule that help here is the phagosome. So phagosome will provide the environment for the chopping process to be in a good factory, basically the chopping, it means cutting factory, okay? So this is antigen presentation process and it can happen in macrophage as well. But right now, for this point, basically first one, MSC class 2 take care of extracellular antigen, okay? And MSC peptide in the context of MSC class 2 will present to CD4 T cell, okay? And what else? It can be CD4 T cell can now activate and then interact with B cell to enhance or to make T cell know, a B cell know that they have to differentiate into antibody factory. So I would say this is some kind of picture that I want you to get the concept. But in each step here, like here, it is a lot of detail in there. But once you have this picture in your head, you read, right? And then you will try to add up like, hey, what would be the thing that happened here? And when you have proliferation of CD4 T cell, what would be something that happened? And after CD4 T cell get activated, what would be the next step that they can do? They can also come help CD8 T cell to differentiate. They can interact with B cell to make B cell become the cell that can produce antibody. And of course, they make the B cell to differentiate into memory cell. And this memory cell is very good for the next infection. Hopefully, we're not gonna get sick by the same antigen for the second time. And the other thing is once they get activated, they can produce the messenger like cytokine or something that can enhance the immune cell activity, other immune cell activity. So this is kind of like a network. Okay. So for the B cell itself, okay, it can, this is the whole chunk of B cell. This is lymphocyte precursor, right? It's like I said, one B cell, one T cell recognize only one antigen, right? You have so many color of T cell here, right? Right here, you have ton of cell that recognize different thing. And once you get the antigen X in, and antigen X basically interact with the purple one. So this purple B cell will be proliferate, right? And you have more and more of this B cell. At the same time, this purple B cell differentiate into a plasma cell and produce antibody. So this is clonal selection in this picture. But the detail of the signal and cytokine that involved in this process is very detailed. And I will send you the reference that you can read as well, apart from whatever example we already told you, okay? And this is the function of, we're talking about antibody function before, right? But this is the main three things that I would like you to know. At least this is key step, key main thing that antibody do when they interact with the pathogen. First one, they neutralize. Neutralize means that they inhibit, okay? Antibody prevent the virus or the pathogen from to get into the cell. Think about this, when you have a virus come in, let's say influenza, the target cell will be epithelium cell, right? So usually the virus will bind to the receptor and then get into the cell. But if you have the antibody there, antibody can be just bind but not neutralize. They don't have ability to neutralize. That called non-neutralizing antibody. You don't need it. When people make the vaccine or when you get sick, you want something called neutralizing vaccine that can inhibit either entry or the process afterward. But it doesn't mean that non-neutralizing antibody is not important. It's important as well because the non-neutralizing antibody can basically enhance another mechanism like ADCC, something that we are going to discuss about cell-mediated killing next week. If I don't mention about ADCC in next class, remind me. But that is something that non-neutralizing antibody can do. So the first one is they neutralize. This is good thing. You want it. The vaccinologist wants it. You want neutralizing antibody. Okay. And antibody can do something called opsonization as well. Because once, same thing like you remember the complement that I'm showing you, the picture of the butter on the biscuit. The antibody can act the same way by interact with the pathogen, paint it, and then make it more obvious for the macrophage to come in. And once you put butter in, it's yummy, right? So the macrophage come in and eat, and they love it. So this is another another function of antibody as well. The third one is complement fixation. Like we already discussed that we need the Fc portion of the antibody to interact with C1, right? And it form, eventually it will form membrane attack complex that destroy the pathogen. So this is three things that I would like you to know, okay? Okay, now this is, I think we almost the end, but this is the phase of adaptive immune response. So you have how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay. You have to have antigen recognition, okay? You have antigen come in, antigen presenting cell has to present antigen to B cell, I mean T cell, B cell recognize antigen. This is the first step. And then good antigen, like the one that's specific, will be expand. So this is clonal expansion, right? And you have to have different, this is in the activation phase. You have to have those cells differentiate into a good army. You educate them and they have to be a good army. They know that they have to be specialized in producing antibodies. They have to be specialized in killing. I'm gonna be killed. So this is the activation state. You kind of like activate them. And then you have elimination state. Now you have an army that ready, right? I am going to kill because I get trained very well. I'm gonna kill. So this is the killing part that you eliminate antigen out from the body. Once the war is stopped, you don't need a lot of cell, right? You just need a certain amount. So some cell has to be gone because otherwise you will be too much activated. So this is called contraction phase or homeostasis. And you have a last one that is very important. The one that survive, memory cell that survive will be the surviving memory. And this is will run around waiting for, well, this cell will waiting for the next infection, for example. Usually the day after the antigen exposure, you need allow 20-21 day. This is sometimes when people give the vaccine, right? You get the vaccine. It doesn't mean next day you're gonna have antibody against those pathogen that you wanna have immune to against. For example, you get influenza vaccine today. It doesn't mean that tomorrow you will have antibody ready for combat the influenza, natural infection. For usually for T cell response, once you get antigen, you need allow like 7 to 10 days to have T cell response. And then for the antibody response, usually people wait allow 28 days to get the antibody. So when people try the vaccine, you know, right? If you have a new vaccine, for example, you have invent the COVID vaccine today and you want to test in animal. If you inject the animal today with the vaccine and you want to see T cell respond, the best day to harvest spring to see T cell response is on day 7 to day 10. If you do before that, you're not going to see anything. If you do later than that, you might not be able to get the day that have a peak of that T cell response. However, if you want to do the antibody testing in those animals, you have to wait maybe at least 14 days, but I'm sure that usually the antibody response will kick out around like day 20 or day 28 between that. And that is immunology, basic immunology that you can use it for another immunological application. And when we discuss about passive immunization and vaccine, I will discuss about this point again. Okay, and this is the how the secondary response is occur. Okay, so the purple one, the purple one is the primary response to antigen X, right? You have antigen X here. You give them the antigen X here. And then this is the peak of antibody response. You can see it's small peak, right? Right here. You have that antibody response. Here you have plasma cell that produce a lot of antibody. Then it is memory. You're not gonna have high level of antibody all the time. But let me put it this way. For some antigen, for example, if you get influenza vaccine today, I can tell you that the antibody to that particular strain of influenza will last for around like 6 months, and then it starts to wane down. And next year, you get antibody to influenza vaccine again, it will come up very quick. But the duration of antibody titer in your body is depend on the type of antigen and depend on the host immune status as well. And here they give antigen X again and then antigen Y. And you can see here, this is primary respond to antigen X, antigen Y, right? This is the first time that we see the antigen Y. So you get a tiny bit of the antibody. But for antibody X, you already know it. You have memory. The memory will expand and produce antibody more. So this is kind of like this one. This one, your body is ready, right? At this point, you have memory already. And once you get antigen again, you just activate this one to get plasma cell and then produce antibody. And you can see here, like for the first time that you see antigen, you will find only small amount of antibody, but the second time you will see more and quicker too, okay? And if third time you put antigen Y in and antigen X in, you will see more antibody of those two things. And this is why that in some vaccine you need prime and boost. So if you get only, you give the vaccine only one shot of the vaccine, you will get a very tiny antibody titer, right? And once you boost it, it will become more and more. So that is why some vaccine you need more than one dose, right? You need more for better antibody response. I think this is probably almost the last. This is kind of like, I want you to see the effector site here, that what antibody do here. And this is what kind of effector function that you can see by the activation of either B cell. B cell, of course, after you activate them, the effector function will be producing antibody, right? And it can neutralize microbe and enhance phagocytosis. It can fix the complement. This is the effector function. I hope if I ask you in the exam that what would be the effector function of B cell, you can tell me at least maybe like some of them here. And if I ask you like, what would be the effector function of activated T cell, helper T cell, it can be activation of macrophage. It's induced inflammation and it proliferate and activate another cell. So this is easy one, okay? I think from this adaptive immune, I mean, humoral immune response, I would say that we stop here on this side, and then next week we will go on the other side here. And by the end of next week class, I will put the whole picture together for you. So from those two from these two cards, like, I mean, today and tomorrow, I mean, next week, when you put everything together, I think you can summarize into only one page. But for innate, it can be separate. And I would say my exam, I would like to see you put everything together. Like, well, we'll see. And Ajahn Pawey said we can give you, we will give you the quiz on the last section, my section next week, right? And you have 1 week to work on it. You can go to the book, give the detail, but the score will come from the concept. Any question from you? So I have 10 minutes left, right? 5-10 minutes.
Ajahn, can I have a question?
Sure.
So considering the memory cell, mm-hmm. is there any specific lifespan that it can stay in our body? Like do they
usually every single memory cell, they have a half-life, you know? Like once they get activated and become memory, they will stay there, but the body try to keep a certain amount, you know? Like if you get infection this day, you will deposit some memory, but different antigen that you interact with, you might get to the different half-life of memory B cell.
Okay, Kat. And I also have another question.
Sure.
So regarding like the response that it would take some time,
mm-hmm.
When do you expect the vaccine for COVID-19 to be fully, like successfully developed?
Well, the thing that I read about today is that they have a new technology called mRNA vaccine. This mRNA vaccine, I think they test it in US right now. Because it's mRNA vaccine and it didn't involve other vector that deliver this mRNA vaccine. So I think it will be quicker than the old-fashioned vaccine that they make. I would think if it's going very well by the end of next year, we should be able to get the COVID-19 vaccine, hopefully. But you know, right? Vaccine, sometimes it takes around 10 years to get it,
yeah.
Right? Think about HIV, right? 30 years, something already, we not get a vaccine yet. But hopefully with the technology today, you can get the COVID-19 faster, I hope. But in the vaccine trial step, you have 3 steps. Think about it. You have phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, right? Phase 1, basically they do safety of the vaccine. But I think US people, they do it now. It's safe because it's mRNA vaccine. The second one, you have to look for safety profile. And you have to enroll certain amount of vaccinee or participant. And you have to pass to the phase 3, which is immunogenicity and safety. You have to have 2 things and efficacy. Then you can put the vaccine into the market. I think 1 year is quite quick, but the news, right? You read from the news, they start to say, right, we're gonna have the vaccine soon. But I think the quickest would be next year. Maybe by that time we already has the herd immunity, who know, right? You know that word, herd immunity, right?
Yeah.
Well, you're waiting for COVID-19 vaccine, right?
I'm kind of interested in that topic.
Yeah. And if you have time, you Google about that mRNA vaccine. I think they have a podcast online that they talk about what they are doing now and the potential to be a candidate vaccine in next year.
Thank you, ha.
You're welcome.
Ajahn, hi. Can I ask something about 28 day that you're saying?
Yes. So here, right, this one, right? So
yes.
this is a thing because we do the vaccine trial in my press. So for the vaccine, usually if you give a participant vaccine today, right? Well, go back one step. When you write the protocol for the vaccine trial, you have to tell that what would be the day that you're gonna get the blood for antibody testing. Usually, the antibody testing will be done on day 28 because we know that it takes a while for the B cell to get educated. Because you need help from helper T cell, you need some you need some interaction between helper T cell and B cell, and the B cell has to be differentiated. It takes time, so that would be around 28 days. But I would say the earliest that you can see is 14 days. But to be sure that you're gonna have an antibody to particular antigen, I mean this is in the vaccine case, it should be 28 days. Should be, but it can be like window time between before 28 and after 28.
Oh, thank you, Ajahn.
Well, keep this question when we discuss about the vaccine on the last day. We may talk about this, and I will show you that different antigen, different kind of vaccine. Sometimes you get the response. Not exactly the same. Some vaccine lead to cytotoxic T cell response. Some vaccine go to the antibody response. But the most important thing that people want is neutralizing antibody. Okay.
And it's the day is different for our immune system, right? Our immune system would take days before the vaccines take longer, something like that.
You mean a different person has maybe react in a different way. Is that what you mean?
No, I mean for the vaccine that you're saying, for the testing is around like the best is for 28 days.
Yeah.
But from the pictures is that our own adaptive immunity is like the best around 10 to 14 days.
Yes.
So the time is different between getting the antibody from vaccine and our own adaptive immune system adapt?
That 28 day, I would say the number that I mentioned about is that it's come from the vaccine part. But you're right, for the natural, like adaptive immune response for natural infection, it depends. It can be faster than that, or it can be slower than that, but it's certainly in that certain period, allow 2 weeks, I would say, for the
infection.
Is that too difficult, too easy, you think? So I will know that next time I will add more, or what do you want it to be? Because
Me, it's really not too easy. It's a little bit complicated already. But okay, I like the challenge, but
okay,
not more.
Because I don't know your background very well. So well, it's a lot of students in here, right? Different student has different background. I try to make it like as simple as I can because I know that it's complicated. But I don't want you to freak out. It's not that complicated. Okay. Anything else?
I'm sorry, but may I interrupt a little bit? I want to ask you about the contraction phase.
Mm-hmm.
You said too much activation of like what you say soldier could be not good. Can you be like more can specific? You qualify on
okay,
that?
Okay. So basically you when you get the invader come in, right? You basically wanna get your soil out as many as you can because you wanna get rid of the enemy, right? But once the war is stopped here, you win. You already win. You can't get that much soil, otherwise you will have something called immunopathology because your immune are too much activate. You have to calm them down. So the body is smart, they're not gonna keep all of it, they're gonna get rid of some. and keep only the good one, like a memory one to like a well like a good one to patrol for next time that the pathogen come, you know, like I would say this is something that you calm down your immune response, not get it over activate.
And can I ask more about what you say immunopathology, like what could be like the incidents?
Okay, let's use this one.
After that,
let's use it like this one. So if you have a lot of immune cell, right, you get when your immune cell get activated, you might have ton of cytokine come out, right? For example, like this COVID-19, right? You see that people who get sick, they have a pathology in lung, right? They have some severe symptom in the lung. But that may not be because of the virus itself, but it can be because the immune cell try to fight so hard until they produce too much cytokine in. It's called cytokine storm. So you have a storm in there and you damage everything, right? That is called immunopathology. It's the pathogenesis that happened because your own immune cell. It's not because the invader, you.
Yeah, that's very clear, Kha-chan. Thank you.
Yeah, that is something that I think a lot of viral infection, the virus itself is not as scary as how your body react to it. Because cytokine storm is addressed in so many viral infection, like, you know, you remember that avian influenza one? That one, the pathogenesis happened because of cytokine storm as well. And I think a lot of literature right now about COVID start to talking about the cytokine storm as well. Okay,
thank you so much.
You're welcome. Okay. Ajahn Poet.
So we'll see you again on the next Thursday, okay?
12. But by the way, if you guys have a question after this one, after you go back and read at home, and you have more questions, you email me. Or we have another way to communicate, Ajahn Poet.
Yes.
How?
Well, to share the idea to your friends in the class, you just post the question on the Google Classroom, and then every student can see and share. They learn together with you, okay? That's the right way. And well, I'm very happy. The class today is very active and it's so fun, right? Keep active like this and keep reading, because do not underestimate medical microbiology. It is so, it's actually the knowledge is quite a lot, and this is a 4-credit course. So I would like everyone get A in this class.
Okay. Mm-hmm, me too. Yes, good.
So we try to help you answer whatever you want. Okay. This is very, very important. Don't forget, if you have any question, post the question on the Google Classroom and we try to go to answer. Okay. So if no more questions, see you again on the next Thursday. All right. Okay. Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ajahn.
Thank you,
Ajahn.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.